Good morning, students. Today we will study few topics under this chapter, organisms and populations. We have already started the chapter. We have studied about what is ecology, what are the different levels of organization that we find in an organism. Okay, under this I told you that these four are the basic level of organization, where the ecological hierarchy actually starts with organism. Okay, many organism leads to population, population leads to community, community when it is combined with abiotic factors, it forms ecosystem, ecosystem leads to biomes, biome leads to biosphere. Okay, and we have studied all the terms that that comes under ecological hierarchy or levels of organization in ecology. Okay, the levels of organization itself is known as ecological hierarchy. Okay, in the hierarchy, organism comes at the lowest level, then little above organism we have population, and the higher one is community, the still higher is ecosystem, biome is still higher, biosphere is the largest level of organization that we find in an ecological hierarchy. Okay, how seasons are formed, how biomes are formed, which are the major abiotic factors which are present in an ecosystem. Okay, we have studied about temperature, water, light and soil. Okay, so till now we have studied what is organism, what is population, what are the different abiotic factors present in an ecosystem. In today's class we will study how organisms responds to changing environment. As we already discussed, environment is something which is not going to be the same throughout the year. Okay, the environment changes, so does the behavior of the organism also. Okay, so let's see, when the environment changes or when the abiotic factors change, how the organism will respond to that particular change. Okay, that's what we will be studying in today's topic. Response of organisms to abiotic factors. How organism, living organisms like us, we will respond to abiotic factors like change in temperature, change in water quality, change in soil, light intensity. How we respond to these changes. Okay, initially you must know the meaning of this term homeostasis. Okay, homeostasis is a process where an organism maintains a constant internal environment even though the outside environment is changing. Okay, I hope you are able to understand this sentence. Whatever may be the changes happening in the environment, I am going to maintain my constant body environment. Okay, my body's environment, when I say body's environment, inside environment will not change depending on the changes that is happening in the outside environment. I am going to maintain a constant internal environment, that is in environment within my body. That is known as homeostasis. As you all know, human beings, we all mammals are warm-blooded animals. Okay, even the birds, mammals and apes are represented as warm-blooded animals. Why are we called as warm-blooded animals? Because we have the ability to maintain our constant body temperature. Okay, what is the temperature of our human body? Human's body temperature, internal temperature is 37 degrees Celsius. And we maintain that temperature irrespective of whatever is happening in the external environment. It doesn't happen that if you go to a very cold region, if the temperature there is 5 degrees Celsius, your body's temperature will also changes to 5 degrees. It doesn't happen. Okay, when you go to a region where there is temperature of 5 degrees Celsius, still your body maintains a internal temperature of 37 degrees Celsius. okay, or if you go to a desert where the temperature is 55 degrees Celsius, your body's temperature will not raise to 55 degrees Celsius. You are still going to maintain that constant internal temperature of 37 degrees Celsius. This is known as homeostasis. Irrespective of whatever is happening in the environment, whatever changes are happening in the environment, our body is going to maintain a constant internal environment. Okay, this process is known as homeostasis. Okay, let's read this. The process by which the organism maintains a constant internal environment in respect to changing external environment is known as homeostasis. What is environment? Environment means sum of all biotic and abiotic factors that surround and influence of an organism in its survival and reproduction. Okay, so this is the explanation for environment. What is an environment? Environment means it does not only carry abiotic factors, it also carry abiotic factors. Okay, so it is a sum or combination of both biotic and abiotic factors. Okay, abiotic factors, when I say the temperature, soil, light, water, whatever lifeless factors are present in my surrounding, they are known as abiotic factors. Then what are abiotic factors to me? I am an organism, living organism. For me, all the other living organisms which are present in my surrounding, as well as the plants, microorganisms, any other living organism present in my surrounding are known as my other biotic factors. So it is a combination of biotic and abiotic factors that surrounds and influence an organism. So this biotic and abiotic factors does not only surround us, they also influence us. Influence in what? In its survival and reproduction. Okay, these organisms, all the biotic and abiotic factors which are surrounding to me, they will not only help me in surviving, they will also help in the reproduction also. So the combination of biotic and abiotic factors are equally important to any living organism. So let's look into this important topic and very interesting topic also. How does organism cope up with the changing environment? How any organism will cope up with the environment that is constantly changing? So these two are the mechanisms through which organisms will cope up with the changing environment. Okay, so which are the two phenomena? Regulate is the first one, conform is the second one. How organisms will adjust to the changing environment? It happens through two different ways. One is regulate, another one is conform. Okay, regulate and conform. Let's study in detail what is regulate. Okay, regulate means controlling. Okay, regulate. Regulate means whatever is happening in my surrounding environment, I am not going to change according to it. I will maintain my constant internal environment no matter what happens in the external environment. This is regulate. Okay, so what is conform? Conform means I will change my body depending upon what is happening in the surrounding, in my surrounding. Okay, so regulate means no matter what happens in the external environment, my internal environment is going to remain the same. That is regulate. Okay, so this is the capacity of few organisms. What is conform? My body's environment will change depending upon the changing external environment. In simple terms, this is conform. We will study in detail. Let's look into regulate. Some organisms are able to maintain homeostasis by physiological and behavioral means. Okay, few organisms, what happens when the external environment is changing? They will maintain homeostasis. We have already explained homeostasis. What is homeostasis? Maintaining a constant internal environment. Okay, so no matter what happens in the external environment, few organisms, they are able to maintain homeostasis. That means they will maintain their constant internal environment. How? By physiological and behavioral means. By changing their behavior and by changing their physiology. Physiology is how your body functions. Physiology is nothing but physiology is nothing but how your body functions. Okay, so when there is any change in internal environment, what happens? You want to maintain a constant internal environment. That is the reason you will change your physiological behavior. That means you will change how your body internally is functioning. Okay, you will change your body's internal function. What are the examples for changing the body's function? It could be release of certain kind of hormones. It could be a kind of shivering. It could be sweating. Okay, all these are known as physiological changes. That means your body's function is changing in order to adjust to the external environment, because your body wants to maintain a constant internal environment. It cannot cope up with the, it does not want to change according to the change in the external environment. So how you maintain homeostasis? We are example, we are human beings, we are an examples of organisms which respond to abiotic factors through regulating. Okay, so regulate, you can take an example of human beings. We maintain homeostasis. How? By physiological. That means changing our internal body function and behavioral means, or sometimes our behavior. Okay, you know what happens when we feel cold. What steps we take when we usually feel hot. Okay, all birds and mammals, as I already told you, birds and mammals are represented as warm-blooded animals, and few lower invertebrates. You know which are lower invertebrates? Like we have studied in our first year class, all the lower invertebrates like porifera, helminthus, platyhelminthus, coelenterates. Okay, so these organisms are generally referred as lower invertebrates. Under those lower invertebrates, there are only few, not all lower invertebrates, only few lower invertebrates are capable of such regulation. Okay, so only birds, mammals, and few lower invertebrates are capable of such regulation. Regulation means regulating our body function, that is homeostasis. What are the different types of regulation? There is something known as thermoregulation and osmoregulation. Thermoregulation means controlling our body temperature, thermo. Okay, whatever temperature is present outside our body, we try to maintain a constant temperature of 37 degrees Celsius. I have already told you my body temperature is 37 degrees Celsius. No matter what is the temperature in the surrounding environment, my body's temperature will be 37 degrees Celsius. I am not going to increase or decrease it. Okay, so this particular regulation or control is known as thermoregulation. Osmoregulation. Osmoregulation means maintaining a constant osmotic concentration. Okay, maintaining a constant osmotic concentration. What is the osmotic concentration? You know, our body is full of fluids. Right? There are multiple fluids like blood present in our body. Okay, like when I say multiple fluids, blood, semen, saliva, all these are represented as body fluids. Okay, so all the fluids which is present in our body, it has a particular osmotic concentration. What is osmotic concentration? It is a concentration of the given by the presence of water and salts present in that particular fluid. Okay, any fluid, let's take an example, our blood. our blood carries water as well as few salts or ions in it. Okay, it could be electrolytes and non-electrolytes. Okay, there is a combination of salts and water in any particular fluid. When I say salt, like sodium, potassium, we have different types of salts in our body fluid. Okay, the concentration of this water and salt together gives osmotic concentration to that particular fluid. Okay, so maintaining the osmotic concentration at that particular level itself is known as osmoregulation. Okay, we have seen when we soak any particular fruit, you take a mango, okay, raw mango, you put it in a you soak it in salt water for a very long time. What happens? The mango shrinks. Why the mango is shrinking? Because the water content which is present inside the mango, it has diffused into the surrounding salt water. Okay, why? Because we have studied osmosis, diffusion, everything in our previous classes, in our first year classes. Okay, so what happens? The water content which is present inside the mango, it diffuses into the salt water in which you are soaking the particular mango. Okay, why? Because inside the mango the water concentration was more, in the salt water the water concentration was less, where the salt content was more. Okay, now water diffused from the mango into the salt water. Okay, this particular these particular processes does not happen in our body. We maintain a constant osmotic concentration. Okay, if in our body fluid, for example blood, this much water and this much salt has to be present, we will maintain that particular water and salt content no matter what happens. Okay, so that is known as osmoregulation, maintaining a particular osmotic concentration in our body. Okay, how we maintain osmotic concentration? We do not change the concentration of water and salt. We maintain a particular concentration of water and salt in our body fluids. That is known as osmoregulation. So, regulation is of two types. Thermoregulation, maintaining particular body temperature. Osmoregulation is maintaining a particular osmotic concentration of all the body fluids. Okay, now success of mammals is due to thermoregulation. You know, mammals are the most advanced organisms. Why we are called as successful organisms? Because of our thermoregulation. We maintain a constant body temperature of 37 degrees Celsius. Okay, when outside temperature is high, what we do? When outside temperature is high, we want to maintain a constant internal environment. It does not happen so easily, right? So imagine outside temperature is 55 degrees Celsius. Inside your body, the temperature is 37 degrees Celsius. When the external temperature is 55, your body will not increase your body temperature from 37 to 55. It does not happen. Then what does your body do? You will start sweating, right? When we are in a warmer region, we start sweating. Sweating is a kind of activity carried out by your body in order to maintain a temperature of 37 degrees Celsius. Okay, we have an inbuilt mechanism known as sweating. We sweat profusely, right? When we are in a warmer, hot region, continuously we tend to sweat. What happens when we sweat? Water evaporates from our body. So that leads to evaporative cooling. When you start sweating, your body will start to cool down. Okay, your body was struggling initially to cope up with the high temperature. When you started sweating, the water starts evaporating. That leads to evaporative cooling. It cools your body surface. Okay, when your body surface cools, your body temperature is brought down. Okay, and evaporative cooling takes place to bring down body temperature. Your body temperature comes down when you sweat profusely. So you maintain a constant temperature of 37 degrees Celsius. Now, What happens when there is low temperature? Imagine your body temperature is 37. You have gone to a region which is having a temperature of 7 degrees Celsius. Does your body decrease the body temperature to 7 degrees Celsius? No. Because you are a warm-blooded animal, you maintain homeostasis, a constant internal environment. So what you do? You start shivering. Right? When we go to a colder region, what we do? Our body starts shivering. Why do we shiver? In order to generate heat. Okay, shivering is it's a physiological process that is happening. Why is it happening? In order to raise your body temperature. When we shiver, our body starts producing heat. Our body produces heat when we shiver. So that is the reason, ultimately our body temperature increases. So when there is increased external temperature, our body sweat. When there is decreased external temperature, our body shivers. These are the two physiological means we have adapted in order to cope up with the changing temperature. So this is the example for how we do thermoregulation. So changing environment through different mechanism, one is regulate, another one is conform. Regulate is a mechanism generally adapted by warm-blooded animals. Conform is a phenomenon adopted by, or a type of response adopted by, cold-blooded animals. Okay, generally conform is adapted by cold-blooded animals. What is conform? Let's look into it. Majority of animals, that is 99% of animals, and nearly all plants cannot maintain a constant internal environment. Their body temperature varies according to ambient temperature. Ambient temperature means surrounding temperature. As you can see here, majority of the animals, they cannot maintain a constant body temperature. Their body temperature varies depending upon the surrounding temperature. In aquatic animals, that's about thermoregulation. It indicates they cannot have the property of thermoregulation. They cannot carry out thermoregulation. In aquatic animals or animals living in water, the osmotic concentration of body fluid varies with ambient water osmotic concentration. Okay, ambient water osmotic concentration means the surrounding osmotic concentration. There are certain animals which lives exclusively in water. When they are living in water, their body fluid have a particular osmotic concentration. However, they do not maintain a particular osmotic concentration. They do not maintain a fixed osmotic concentration. Their body fluids osmotic concentration changes depending on the surrounding water concentration. Okay, what osmotic concentration is present in the surrounding water? Okay, in the surrounding water, what is the quantity of water and salts? Okay, so depending upon that, they also change their body osmotic concentration. All the above animals and plants are simply called as conformers. Okay, the organisms which have adapted this mechanism of conform as a response to a changing environment, such organisms are known as conformers. Okay, next topic is why the conformers not evolved to become regulators. This is an interesting question. We are saying 99% of animals and nearly all plants are conformers. Okay, whereas we spoke here about regulate mechanism, where I told you that birds and animals and only few lower invertebrates have the capacity to regulate. Okay, it seems easy, if the organism adapts to this regulate mechanism, then life could go easily. Okay, why these conformers did not become regulators? Regulators are the organism which will maintain a constant body temperature, constant internal environment. Conformers cannot maintain a constant body environment. Okay. Now the question is, why conformers did not evolve into regulators? You know, over the period of time, generally organisms evolve, right? So there is a question, why conformers, the organism which cannot maintain a constant internal environment, why these organisms did not evolve to become a regulator? Regulator means who will maintain a constant body environment, constant internal environment. Okay, why the conformers not evolved to become regulators? Why didn't they become regulators? Or why can't they become regulators? The answer is very interesting. Thermoregulation is energetically expensive for many animals. I told you, thermoregulation means no matter what the external temperature is, my body will maintain a temperature of 37 degrees Celsius. We are taking an example of human beings itself. Okay? So my body is maintaining a constant temperature of 37 degrees Celsius. It is not easy. I told you we have to sweat profusely or shiver when there is increase or decrease in the temperature. That is not so easy. It is energetically expensive for many animals. That means we require lot of energy in order to do this. Okay, it is energetically expensive, very costly. Okay, very, very costly, very expensive in terms of energy. That means we need more and more energy in order to maintain thermoregulation. Small animals cannot afford so much energy for thermoregulation. Okay, small animals cannot may have, you know, they do not have so much energy to carry out thermoregulation. They cannot afford. Okay, they cannot afford to have so much energy for thermoregulation. Heat loss or heat gain is a function of surface area. Okay, this is interesting to know. Heat loss, I told you, you know, from the surface of our, I told you that, you know, when there is increased temperature, we sweat profusely. That means water evaporates from our body surface. Okay, so that process is known as heat loss. Okay, that process is known as heat loss. Now when the temperature is cold, we shiver. Okay, so that process, you know, that is in order to increase the body temperature. So that process is known as heat gain. Okay, heat loss and heat gain, both are, you know, it is a function of surface area. Surface area means our body external surface. Okay, how much surface area that we have in our body, depending upon that, heat loss and heat gain happens. Okay, still we did not get the answer why conformers did not become regulators. Why conformers cannot become this regulators. Now here if you see, small animals, they usually, imagine any small animal, they have a larger surface area relative to their volume. Okay, if you take a very you know, small animal, when compared to their body volume or body size, their surface area is more. Okay, if you take a very small animal, listen carefully, if you take a very small animal, you know, if you look at the size of that particular animal, when compared to the size of the animal, let's take this as a small animal. Okay, when compared to the size of this particular animal or volume, that's what we say. Volume is like how much space it is going to occupy, right? So, no, it ultimately indicates the size. Depending upon, no, when compared to the size of this organism, the surface area is very large. This is what happens in, this is the difference between larger animal and smaller animal. Smaller animals will have, you know, very smaller volume, but their surface area will be more. Okay, whereas larger animals, their volume is high, their size is high, bigger. However, the surface area of their body is little lesser. Okay, so we have already studied here is heat loss or heat gain is a function of surface area. Imagine organism who have more surface area, they tend to lose heat very fast. Okay, the organism which have more surface area, they lose heat very fast. So imagine this is a small animal, their surface area is very big when compared to their size. Size is very small, but their body surface area is big. So this animal, as soon as the external temperature is, the external temperature varies, it reacts very fast because they have a larger surface area. Okay, let's look into this. Small animals have larger surface area relative to their volume. Okay, when compared to their body volume, they have a large surface area. That is the reason they tend to lose body heat very fast when it is cold outside. So when it is cold outside, the temperature is very less outside, I should also reduce my temperature inside the body. Immediately they will lose heat. Okay, since their surface area is big, they will lose heat very fast. Okay, losing is okay when the temperature is cold outside. This animal which has small volume but larger surface area, they will release heat from their body in order to match with the surrounding temperature. However, if it has to regain the heat, it is going to be very expensive for this animal. It needs lot and lot of energy to regain that particular heat that has been lost. Okay, but since this is a very small animal with very small volume, this expensive process will cost too much for this particular animal. Okay, well, let's read it again. Heat loss or heat gain is a function of surface area. That means if an organism is having more surface area, it will lose heat very fast. Okay, small animals have larger surface area relative to their volume. They tend to lose body heat very fast when it is cold outside. Then it has to expend much energy to generate body heat through metabolism. Then once the external temperature is cold, this loses heat very fast because they have a larger body surface. Then again, in order to gain that energy, gain that heat or the temperature back, it has to it needs more and more energy. That energy has to come through metabolism. So this is a very risky and expensive process for this particular animal. That is the reason they do not become regulators, they stay as confirmers. Okay, they have a largest, then it has to expend much energy to generate body heat through metabolism. This is why very small animals are rarely found in polar regions. Okay, so there could be a question where they will be asking you, why very small animals are rarely found in polar regions? Why in the polar regions? As you know, polar regions are the regions where you will find ice all over. Okay, all over. So that is they will ask you the question, why in this particular polar regions we will find, why we rarely find very small animals? The answer is, very in the polar regions, obviously, it is a ice filled region. The temperature will be very less. If you leave any very small animal here, their body volume is less, whereas the body surface is more, they will lose lot of energy through their body surface in order to cope up with the external cold temperature. Then in order to gain that energy heat back, it has to utilize more and more energy. If it needs energy, then it has to carry out metabolism. So it is an expensive process for this particular animal. Okay, this is why very small animals are rarely found in polar regions. The answer is, this. Okay. So the next topic is, so now you know how organism cope up with the changing environment, how organism will adjust with the changing environment through two mechanisms. One is regulate, either they regulate or conform. Regulate means they fight, they will maintain a constant in the internal environment no matter what happens in the external environment. Whereas in conform, the body changes according to the surrounding environment. Okay, organism change depending upon surrounding environment. Here, next we will come to another topic where we will discuss about other alternative response for stressful conditions which remain for short duration. Apart from regulate and confirm, there are certain other responses that organism will be having for this change in the external environment or changing abiotic factors. However, this is going to stay for a very short duration. The difference is that, okay, regulate and confirm are the permanent response to abiotic factors or changing environment. However, there are organisms who have adapted certain mechanism in order to overcome this changing environment for a shorter duration. This happens only for shorter duration. This does not prolong throughout their life. Okay, which are those alternative responses? First one is migrate, second one is suspend, third one is adaptation. Okay, so apart from regulate and confirm, which are the major response to abiotic factors, there are three other response to abiotic factors, but the difference is this is going to stay only for a shorter duration. Which are they? The organism will migrate, suspend or adapt. Okay, migrate, suspend, adaptation. So let's look into migrate. Migrate means, now if you feel the area in which you are living is very hot, you go to another area which has cooler weather. That is migrate. I feel this area is very hot at this particular time. Now when it is very hot, I move. I intentionally move on to some other area I move on to a much cooler place. Okay, otherwise, vice versa. If I feel this area is very cold, I cannot cope up with this very cold environment, I move on to a region where there is high temperature. That is migrating. Okay, generally who does this? We all know birds usually, they migrate. Migrate. The organism move away temporarily. Okay, so you have to highlight this point, temporarily, because we are talking about responses which remain for short duration. Okay, now I feel this place is very hot, I move on to a cooler area, I will not stay in that cooler area forever. I will definitely come back to the same old habitat, which is my habitat, after some time. Okay, temporarily they move away from the stressful habitat, any kind of stressful habitat, to a more hospitable area. More hospitable area means more favorable area, which I feel is good for me. Hospitable area, and return when stressful condition is over. Okay, I return. I do not stay in that migrate area for a longer time. I come back. So that is the reason we say it is for short duration. Bird migrate from the colder region to warmer region. Okay, we know this fact. Usually birds, they migrate from colder region to warmer region. Now, example is migration of birds to Keolado National Park, Rajasthan, from Siberia. Okay, from Siberia, when it is cold, few birds migrate from Siberia to Rajasthan. There is a national park in Rajasthan known as Keolado National Park. Birds migrate from Siberia to Rajasthan. Once the conditions are favorable, they again go back to Siberia. Next response which remains for short duration is suspend. Suspend means there is no activity for some time. That is known as suspend. You know the meaning of suspension, right? Suspend means there is no activity for some for some time. After that, again my activity starts. I will suspend my activity for some time. Again, after that suspension time, again I will restart my activity. Examples. This is an alternative response for stressful conditions which remains for short duration. Okay, you must know we are talking about responses which will remain for short duration. Spore formation is the first example. Okay, so these bacteria or sometimes fungus also, when there is adverse environmental condition, when there is some stressful condition or the environmental conditions are not good or not favorable, they produce a structure called as spores. Okay, they produce a structure called as spores. So these spores, it will remain attached to the bacterial body or fungal body till that adverse conditions are over or unfavorable condition is over. After the favorable conditions are reached, these spores come out of the bacterial body, they develop into a new bacteria. Okay, here if you see, this is a bacteria. Okay, the normal vegetative cell. Okay, now what happens? Imagine there is some stressful condition or unfavorable condition. The bacteria will start producing spore. This is a kind of endospore. There are two types of spores, endospore and exospore. Endospore is produced inside the bacterial cell. Exospores are produced outside the bacterial cell. Okay, so this is a kind of endospore. See, here the bacteria will initiate the spore formation. Spore formation begins with the formation of a septum. Septum means a wall. Inside the bacterial cell itself, there is a formation of a wall. Then it increases in size, it grows further, it develops its own wall. Okay, it becomes a spore. Okay, till now the spore which is produced inside the bacteria will produce spore only during stressful condition. Okay, now the spore is present inside the bacterial cell. Now imagine there is favorable condition. The stressful condition is gone. Now there is some favorable condition. The bacterial cell lyses or it will break. Okay, and the spore will come out. Spore will develop into a new bacteria again. Okay, so this condition is known as suspend state of bacteria. Okay, the bacteria suspends its growth. Okay, now in that particular time it produces spore. Here you see thick-walled spores. These spores are thick-walled. Here you can see, compared to the normal bacterial cell, these spores have very thick wall surrounding to it. Thick-walled spores are formed in microbes to overcome unfavorable stressful external environment. Spores germinate in favorable condition. Okay, the spores will germinate and it will produce a new bacteria again. In plants, what happens? Seeds. Okay, the product of sexual reproduction is seeds. These seeds will remain in dormant state for a very long time. Okay, however, when there is enough moisture and when there is favorable conditions available to the seeds, only then the seeds will germinate. Okay, so this condition also can be called as suspend. Okay, the seeds will not immediately germinate as soon as the plant produces it. It will wait for the favorable conditions. It will stay in a state of dormancy. It does not germinate and produce a new plant. It will stay in a state of dormancy. When the favorable conditions are back, it will germinate and produce a new plant. Okay, other vegetative reproductive structures also. We have discussed about vegetative reproductive structures like rhizome, bulbils, bulbs. Okay, all these structures also, when there is favorable conditions only, they will develop a new plant. Okay, they are means to tide over the stress. They reduce their metabolic activity and go into a state of dormancy. I told you the seeds, as soon as they are formed, they will not germinate to produce a new plant. They will go into a state of dormancy. Dormancy means there is no metabolic activity. there is no metabolism at taking place inside the seed. Only once the favorable conditions are packed, these seeds will germinate and they will produce a new plant. Then the next type of suspend response is hibernation. Hibernation, we all know, during winter animals like bears escape in time to avoid the stress. Okay, what happens is when animals sense, especially animals like bear, they sense that the next season is going to be winter. They do not get sufficient food in the winter season and the temperature is also very cold. They cannot withstand it. So they will decide to suspend their growth. Suspend their growth means they will eat quite a lot when they get sufficient food before winter. They eat a lot of food. They store a lot of fat in their body. And they go into a state known as hibernation. They enter their cave or den. They will sleep in the den for few weeks to few months. In this particular time, what happens is their body metabolism is very low. Okay, or the metabolic rate is very low. Okay, that means all the reactions that is taking place inside their body, the rate of it becomes very low. Their breathing pattern is also very low. Okay, a few organisms breathe only once in 20 to 30 minutes. Okay, only once they breathe in 20 to 30 minutes. Okay, and their heart rate also drastically decreases. Few organisms, their heart beats only 4 times in an hour. Okay, so this is what happens during hibernation. Why do they do it? In order to conserve energy. Why the heart rate, breathing pattern, metabolism decreases? In order to save the energy. Okay, because they are going to sleep there for few weeks to few months. Okay, months together, they need to have that energy. So in order to conserve this energy, these organisms' metabolism rate decreases, the heart rate beating rate decreases, breathing rate decreases. So this is known as hibernation. There are many organisms who go into the state of hibernation during winter. So hibernation is also known as winter sleep. Okay, the organisms generally sleep throughout winter. Okay, here I have given the picture of a bear which is in the period of hibernation, which is hibernating. Okay, it went inside the cave and it is hibernating there. It won't come out or it won't wake up for few weeks to months together. Okay, as soon as the winter is over, they will wake up and they come out of the cave. By the time whatever fat they had stored in their body, it will be consumed in that particular season, hibernating period. So the next is aestivation. Aestivation is a process where it is just like hibernation. Hibernation, what did I say? It is known as winter sleep. Organisms sleep during winter. Here aestivation is known as summer sleep. Few organisms, what happens is they cannot cope up with the high temperature during summer. That is the reason they go for a suspended state, which is known as aestivation. Aestivations mean summer sleep. They sleep during summer. They do not wake up till the summer gets over. Animals like snail and fish avoid summer related problems like heat and desiccation. These organisms, what they do is when there is a high intensity of sunlight, they find a shady area. Here I have given snails and fish, certain fish. They will search for a shady area. They go to that particular shady area. They will sleep there till the summer is over in that particular shady areas. So this particular process is also example for suspend response. Okay, it's known as aestivation. Can also be referred as summer sleep. Okay, why they will go into the stage of aestivation? In order to avoid summer related problems like heat and desiccation. Okay, the, when there is more and more of heat, okay, the drying also, the heating and the desiccation. Desiccation is something where if there is too much of heat and it appears, it happens that the organisms will start getting dried. So that in order to avoid this, they go into a state of estivation, suspension. The last type of suspend response is diapause. Many zooplanktons undergo a stage of suspended development in unfavorable conditions. Okay, this question has been asked in previous year exams. What is diapause? Okay, diapause is the condition where many zooplanktons, they will suspend their growth for some particular time. When I say suspend, the metabolic activity will be very, very low in that particular organism. Here, diapause is carried out by zooplanktons. What are zooplanktons? There are certain small animals which float in the water body. Okay, here you can see these are the pictures of zooplanktons. There are certain organism which will float in the water body. Okay, so how do we identify them? They usually do not swim against the water current. They actually just keep floating when there is the waves coming, or the when there is water current, okay, it just flows along with the wind. So it flows along with the waves. Okay, so they do not swim; they just float. Okay, such organisms are known as zooplanktons. Okay, small animals. Okay, there are also organisms known as phytoplanktons. When there are certain plants which float in the water body, water surface, they are known as phytoplanktons. Zoo means animals, small animals which actually float in the water surface are known as zooplanktons. The meaning of plankton is wandering, organism which wander. Wandering is, not intentionally, it does not swim, it only floats in the water current according to the waves. So what happens? These organisms, they go to a suspended development. That means completely reducing their metabolic activity. So in unfavorable conditions, such phenomenon is known as diapause. This is an example for suspended response. So under suspended response, we have studied about spore formations, seed formation and the vegetative reproductive structures, hibernation, estivation, which is summer sleep, and diapause. Diapause is carried out by planktons. Okay, so this is a hibernating bear. These are zooplanktons. This is a bacteria producing spore. Now the last type of temporary response to changing abiotic factors is adaptation. We have studied about migrate, we have studied about suspend. The last one is adaptation. Adaptations means nothing but just adjusting to whatever is coming in your way. Okay. Now it is any morphological, physiological and behavioral attribute of an organism that enables the organism to survive and reproduce in its habitat. Okay. So there are certain organisms who will adjust to whatever is happening in its habitat. Okay, how do they adjust? By morphological behavior. Their morphology changes. When some changes are happening in the environment, the body's morphology itself changes depending upon the changing environment. Or physiological, the body internal functioning changes depending upon the surrounding environment. And behavioral attribute, their behavior changes. Okay, their behavior, how they behave, that behavioral pattern changes depending upon the changing environment. Such process is known as adaptation. What is adaptation? We'll read it again. It is any morphological, morphological means the morphology of the body changes, physiological, internal body function, behavioral attributes. Behavioral means how the body behaves, that changes of an organism that enables the organism to survive and reproduce in its orbit. A few organism decides that whatever is happening in the surrounding environment, I am going to stay here, I will change my morphology, I will change my physiology, I will change my behavior. No, ultimately I am going to live in this environment, I am going to reproduce in the same habitat. I am not going to go anywhere or suspend my behavior, suspend my growth. I am not going to do any of them. I will stay here and I will adjust to the changing environment. Okay, let's look into certain adaptations. Okay, let's look into certain adaptations done by few organism. Examples: adaptation of animals in deserts. Okay, how organisms adjust themselves if they are living in desert. We are taking an example of kangaroo rat. This is known as kangaroo rat. Okay, it is present in a desert. Kangaroo rat present in North America meets their water requirement from oxidation of fat, where water is a byproduct. If this kangaroo rat, it lives in desert, as we already discussed, there is very less availability of water in desert. So what this kangaroo rat does is, if it requires water, it will carry out oxidation of fat. Okay, it will digest the fat which is present in its body. Oxidation of fat is digestion of fat in the help of, in the presence of oxygen. Okay, it will digest the fat, or it will carry out oxidation of fat. When oxidation of fat happens, one of the byproducts of this oxidation is water. This is how they will fulfill their requirement of water. Okay, so when they want water, they will meet their water requirement by oxidation of fat. They will carry out oxidation of fat. When oxidation of fat is done, water comes as a byproduct. Then the kangaroo rat uses this water, because they do not get sufficient water to drink whenever they want it. Excrete very concentrated urine to conserve water. This is a very important adaptation of kangaroo rat. In fact, any animal living in desert, they usually excrete very concentrated urine. They do not excrete dilute urine like human beings or any animals which are living in normal tropical region. They do, okay, or they excrete very concentrated urine to conserve water. They, in their body, reabsorption of this urine takes place regularly, so that when they excrete urine, it will be in a very concentrated form. The next is adaptation of plant in desert. Here we have taken an example of kangaroo rat, which is an animal, and we studied how it adapts in desert. Let's see how plants adapt in desert. Okay, xerophytes. Xerophytes are the plants which live in dry condition. Okay, like hydrophytes live in water, xerophytes, they live in very dry condition. So what are their adaptation? If the plants have to survive in a desert, what are their body adaptations? Thick waxy cuticle on their leaf surfaces. Okay, cuticle. What is cuticle? Cuticle is a outermost covering of a leaf. External to the epidermis, there will be a layer known as cuticle. Because of the presence of cuticle, when you put a drop of water on the leaf, it just floats on the surface. It does not get absorbed, because cuticle is generally waxy. It is made up of lipids. Okay, so it looks like wax. That is the reason we say waxy cuticle. If waxy cuticle is there on the leaf surface, what happens? water loss through the surface of water leaf does not happen. Okay, now you take any leaf. Let's take this cactus. Oh, this is opuntia. Okay, so what happens is their leaf surface is they actually do not have leaf, because the leaves are modified thorns there. Let's imagine any one particular leaf where there is, the whole surface of leaf is covered by cuticle, okay, which is very waxy. You put a drop of water, it just floats, it does not get absorbed, okay. So in this particular leaf, why cuticle is present on the upper surface or the outer surface? That is because if cuticle is present, it is waxy. Since it is waxy, water cannot get escaped or water cannot evaporate from the surface of leaf. Since these plants are living in desert, they cannot afford to lose water from the leaf, okay, from the surface of leaf. So that is the reason there is waxy cuticle, which will avoid the evaporation of water from the leaf surface. Sunken stomata in deep pits, okay, on both our lower and you have taken the section of dicot and monocot leaf, you have seen stomata on both upper and lower surface of the leaf. Okay, so this is this is the leaf where section of leaf. Here you can see this is the stomata. Stomata is a small opening. Okay, stomata is a small opening which is present in the outer epidermis. This is the upper epidermis of leaf. This is the lower epidermis. Here in the lower epidermis, you see there is small opening known as stomata. Why stomata is required in the leaf? Stomata actually helps in water water evaporation and also exchange of gases. Through this stomata, water actually escapes from the surface of leaf. Also, exchange of gases between leaf and the environment happens through stomata. You have studied the structure of stomata in detail. So stomata will be generally present in the outermost surface of leaf in normal plants growing in the tropical regions. Whereas if you look into the stomata of a desert plant, here you can see stomata is present here in this particular region. This is known as sunken stomata, the stomata which is buried deep inside a pit. Okay, deep pits. Stomata is buried inside the deep pit so that the water does not get evaporated from the surface of this leaf. So that water does not get, the transpiration does not happen in this particular leaf. Here these plants are growing in water rich areas, so the water gets evaporated, transpiration happens, does not make any difference to the plant. However, if the plants are living in the dry region, then the stomata has to be in a sunken stage. It has to be present in the deep pit, because if the stomata is present in the surface, transpiration happens, a lot of water loss will happen, which is not good for the desert plant. Okay, in order to minimize water loss by transpiration, I have already mentioned that there is more stomata, more transpiration, water loss. Okay, so this does not happen if there is sunken stomata and waxy cuticle. Waxy cuticle also, it will minimize water loss by transpiration from the leaf surface. Have special photosynthetic pathway known as CAM. Learning this chapter known as photosynthesis, we have come across this word known as CAM. CAM represents crassulacean acid metabolism. For this, in this chapter it is not very important. You have already studied it in your first year class. Okay. Just like in normal photosynthesis, there are plants which carry out photosynthetic pathway in the form of CAM, crassulacean acid metabolism. That's what we say. Okay, in this particular plant, there are plants which carry out this particular photosynthetic pathway. in this plant, what is the speciality is, what the speciality is, the stomata is closed during daytime and remain open during night time. Usually stomata remains open during daytime in the normal plants, but wherein the plants in which this type of photosynthesis happens, like crustacean acid metabolism, this type of photosynthesis happens, in this particular plant stomata will close during daytime and it will open during night time. Why? In order to avoid water loss. If the stomata is open during daytime, much sunlight, and there is a chance of more and more transpiration or water loss through the stomata. In order to avoid this, when the sunlight is on, the stomata will be closed. Okay? And when there is no sunlight during night time, the stomata open for the gas exchange, carbon dioxide and oxygen exchange. Okay, so that is another adaptation by plants in deserts. Okay, so this the crustacean acid metabolism or CAM pathway takes place in only plants growing in dry condition or arid condition. Next, we'll talk about open shear. Open shear, this is a type of cactus. Open shear is a type of cactus. One second. The type of genus which comes under cactus family. Okay, so here you see they have, you see these green structures. Actually, it looks like leaf, but they are not leaves. They are the modified stem. Okay, then where are the leaves in this particular plant? The thorns that you see, okay, that the thorns that you see on this particular leaf-like structure, which is actually stem, the thorns that you see on it, they are the actual leaves. The leaves are, the thorns are modified leaves. Okay, why thorn, leaves are not actually leaves, why leaves are modified into thorns? That is because in order to prevent the water loss. If there are more leaves, more water loss. That is the reason the leaves of this particular open shear are converted into thorns. Open shear has no leaf. They are reduced to spikes. Photosynthesis takes place in flat green stems. So here the structure, this green color structure that appears as leaf, they are not leaf, they are actually the stem of this particular plant. Then why only stem? There are no leaves, leaves are present, but in the form of these thorns. Okay, the thorns present in this particular open shear are nothing but the modified leaves, and the leaf-like structure that you see here, the green color flat structure, they are the modified stem. Why this modification? In order to avoid water loss. Open shear has no leaf, they are reduced to spines, photosynthesis takes place in flat green stems. Okay, so this is all about adaptation of animals in deserts and adaptation of plants in deserts. Now we have studied how animals cope up with high temperature in desert, plants cope up with high temperature in the desert. In next class we will look into how animals and plants cope up with colder climatic conditions. Okay, I hope this class is clear to you. Thank you.